Good morning and welcome to Kirk in the Hills. It is good to be in worship with you. If you are visiting us for the first time, I hope you'll take a moment to meet with us in the narthex, that is where you came in, and we'd love to give you information about our ministries and programs here at the Kirk and ways you might get involved. We're really excited about the ways that God is moving. In fact, today we are celebrating our music ministry. We believe God has called people into our lives and into the life of our church to celebrate our music, to help us worship, and we give thanks to God. If you are joining us on our live stream, on our Facebook, or at our Kirk West campus at Fox Run, we're so grateful that you are worshiping with us however you can on this day. If someone would please hold up a pew pad, would you please hold up a pew pad nice and high so everyone can see? We'd love for you to register your visit with us today. Let us know that you were here. If you have any prayer concerns, any information you'd like to share, and we'd love to share all that God is doing here at the Kirk. A couple of announcements for us this morning. We have our Deacon's Flower Ministry every single Sunday. If you could please take a flower to remind yourself of God's love or remind someone else of the same, you are welcome. Our Stephen ministers are available for personal and confidential prayer in Melrose Chapel immediately following the service every single Sunday. So we hope that you would avail yourself of that. We have new member classes that kicked off today following the 9 o'clock service. If you or someone you know is looking for a church home, please share, please let us know so that we can share more about that new member class and we can get you registered. As I shared, we are commissioning our director of music today, Dr. Marilyn Beery, and there will be a reception following this service in Heritage Hall. And also next Tuesday, September 17th, at 11 o'clock in the St. Andrew's Room, the program will feature two representatives. I'm sorry, I should tell you what it is. There's a Kirk Senior Luncheon, and the program will feature two representatives from Leader Dogs for the Blind, accompanied by, get this, one fully trained dog and one puppy in training. Everyone say, aw, aw. You can't say that we're not a fun church, okay? So there's plenty of fun on Tuesday, September 17th. So I hope you'll register for that and share that with a friend. I'd like to invite Reverend Jim Mosley for just a moment here. In your Friday newsletter, we sent out the This Week at the Kirk that Reverend Jim Mosley will be serving in a temporary position as interim executive pastor. So he'll be helping us with some teaching, some preaching, some pastoral care, but also overseeing the business of the church along with Jane Zellers and our wonderful finance team. So if you could please keep him in your prayers, and also if you could introduce yourself to him following the service, we would greatly welcome that. Thank you, Reverend Jim Mosley. You'll notice in your bulletin, he'll be leading the call to worship. This prayer in preparation of worship is actually for you. So that was a misprint. That's for you to pray as you prepare for worship. And in light of that, I want to tell you what's at stake as we worship. For me, it is about the gathering of God's people by the power of the Holy Spirit in Christ's name. It is in worship that we are encouraged. It is in worship that we are reminded of God's love. And it is in worship that we give thanks and are sent out into the world to do the work of God. And the flowers on the altar this morning are presented to the glory of God by Christy and Curtis, who are visiting with us today from Petoskey, worshiping with us this morning. And they're giving in the loving memory of their beloved Kate. Friends, we welcome the Hay family, and we're so thankful that they're here, and we worship together even when times are difficult, even when we grieve, even when we're challenged. Here we're reminded that there is always hope. Friends, let us worship God.
Thank you. Please join your voice with mine in our call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Our help is in the name of the Lord. O come, let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to the rock of our salvation. Singing joyful songs of praise. Grace, we are confident to come before God in prayer. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, your pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not done justice, love kindness, or walk humbly with you, our God. Forgive our sins and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Lord, have mercy on us.
Hear this. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, believe the good news.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. In Jesus Christ we are a new creation.
You may be seated. At this time, I'm going to invite Madam Clerk Linda Jurasik Lippa and Pastor Phil and Dr. Marilyn Beery. Step right there. We will have a commissioning of our new director of music. Let us recognize those who have responded to the call of God to the ministry of music in our church. Singing, playing instruments, and directing ensembles are ministries of Christ among us. In grateful appreciation for the gifts of these ministries, we offer our loyal support and our prayers.
Dr. Marilyn Beery, as a leader of music that lifts praise to God, do you joyfully and willingly offer your skills and training, devotion, and sensitivity to this ministry?
I do, by the grace of God.
And will you honor those with whom you make music and in faithfulness to Jesus Christ, offer your best for the glory of God?
I will, God being my helper.
May the faith expressed by your music live in your heart, and what you believe in your heart practice in your own life. And may God give you grace to offer your music and your life in faithfulness and consecration now and in the world to come.
To the congregation. As a congregation, will you support Dr. Marilyn Beery with your encouragement and your prayers as together we seek to call upon and praise God? And please, the response is in your bulletin. We will, God being our helper,
may God give us all grace to offer our music and our lives in faithful service, thanksgiving, and praise.
Marilyn, I'm going to invite you to come up here, and I'm going to invite the congregation, all those in the choir, acolytes, everyone, to extend your hands out toward Marilyn in a gesture of support and of prayer as I lead us in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord our God, bless this minister of music who offers her talents in your service. Grant her love for you and for all your people. And may her music inspire us all to give glory to your holy name. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, it is appropriate now to give God an offering of applause, thanking God for her ministry among us.
Oh,
Our first scripture reading this morning is Micah 6. God challenges Israel. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth, for the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam son of Beor answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord, and then what God requires. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with tens of thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God, cheating and violence to be punished. The voice of the Lord cries to the city, it is sound wisdom to fear your name. Hear, O tribe and assembly of the city. Can I forget the treasures of wickedness in the house of the wicked and the scant measure that is accursed? Can I tolerate wicked scales in a bag of dishonest weights? Your wealthy are full of violence. Your inhabitants speak lies with tongues of deceit in their mouths. Therefore, I have begun to strike you down, making you desolate because of your sins. You shall eat, but not be satisfied, and there shall be gnawing hunger within you. You shall put away, but not save, and what you save, I will hand over to the sword. You shall sow, but not reap. You shall tread olives, but not anoint yourselves with oil. You shall tread grapes, but not drink wine. For you have kept the statutes of Omri and all the works of the house of Ahab, and you have followed their counsels. Therefore, I will make you a desolation, and your inhabitants an object of hissing, so you shall bear the scorn of my people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hear now the word of God from our second reading, the Gospel according to Luke, the 18th chapter. Then Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, in a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor had the respect of people. In that city, there was a widow who kept coming to the judge and saying to him, give me justice against my accuser. For a while, the judge refused, but later he said to himself, though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice so that she may not wear me out by continually coming to me. And the Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to his chosen ones who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long in helping them? I tell you, he will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. sanctum Dominum et vivificatem, vivificantem. Spiritum sanctum vivificantem, vivificantem Dominum. Qui ex Padre Filio.
Amen. Friends, please join me in a word of prayer. Spirit of the living God, speak to us. Holy Spirit, speak through us. Spirit of the living God, speak in spite of us. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer, in whose name we pray. Amen. Friends, I don't know if you know, but behind that curtain right up there, we have something like the Wizard of Oz. That is Alex and Brad, who help manage our sound and our live stream. And I just want to give them a little note. My microphone sounds a little weird to me. Is that true? So it's maybe a little tinny, a little echoey, a little bit of a buzz. So Alex and Brad, also known as the Wizards of Oz, if you would please do what you can to make that a little better. And thank you all for your patience. So I'm about to describe a moment to you right now. A moment you have all experienced. You've experienced it as a parent, as a grandparent, or when you yourself were a child. And here's the moment. I came home, and my daughter and son, Eva and Eli, who had been playing just fine, I'm told, broke down in a moment. Eli saw Eva playing with a toy he was interested in, and because he admires her, because he wants to copy everything she does, and because according to Eli, this is what love looks like, he tried to take it from her. Now, of course, Eva wasn't having it, and she said, "No, I'm playing with it. It's the toy I've chosen." So Eli tried to pry the toy out of her hands, to which he begins crying, of course, and Eva retorts, "No, it's mine, I'm playing with it." To which Eli retorts, "You're not sharing." And then I, the judge, walk into that situation, and I stepped in it, friends. I can't say I'm proud. I said, "Eva, you're the oldest sibling. I'm tired. We don't want to hear Eli cry. Can you just play with the other toy that seems to me almost exactly the same?" And Eva breaks down crying, "It's not fair." And Eli starts crying, "It's not fair," because she hadn't given the toy yet. And so now everyone's crying. And my wife, Meredith, whose oboe has been beautiful today, and it's great to hear two oboes, two for one deal here. In her wisdom, she says, "You know, as Baba said," that is their grandfather, "life isn't fair. And the sooner you learn that, the better life will be." Even at the ages of 6 and 3, Eli, Eva and Eli know something about fairness, about right and wrong, good and bad, about just and unjust. In fact, theologians like Augustine and John Calvin say it so deeply. A part of us, they call it sensus divinitatis, that is, a sense of the divine within us, like a moral compass. You'll find a sense of justice even in the worst of places. Even in the most dangerous prisons, there is still a kind of justice. As one mafioso might say, "It's okay to kill people who've affected your business, but it's not okay to kill your mama." There are rules, after all, even for the most dangerous criminals. Justice, it seems, is important to us. It's something we deeply long for. It's something we learn about even when we were kids. And today's two scriptures feature two courtroom scenes. Now, the one is obvious. That's Luke 18. That's the one about the unjust judge and the widow. That one's pretty clear, and we'll get to that later. The one you may have missed is Micah 6. It says it really early there in the scripture. "Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. And he will contend with Israel." All these words, but especially that word of pleading one's case, has a judicial and legal meaning there in the Hebrew. It is the Hebrew word reeb. And it is often used to discuss covenant. It is about God saying to the people, "You have not been faithful to the covenant I've established. You've not been faithful to your side of the contract. And so, usually, God is accusing the people of not keeping covenant, except in today's chapter, it isn't all that clear that God is accusing the people of not keeping the covenant, but rather it seems God may even be the defendant, as if the people are accusing God of not keeping covenant. And so that is the context of Micah 6. It's replete with imagery of justice. Imagery of what is right and wrong, what is good and bad, what is just and unjust. Now, in choosing a scripture to talk about the justice of God, it's pretty challenging because the scriptures are full of references to the justice of God. Sometimes translated as the righteousness of God, we find it throughout the Psalms, throughout the Hebrew scriptures, over 330 references to the justice of God. Last week, I had the privilege to talk about the powerful and holy God, and today I get to talk about the just God, that God is a God of justice. And it seems there at the beginning that justice isn't simply deciding right or wrong, but that something great is at stake, that the same God who ordered the universe orders it in a just manner. That is, without justice, there can be no order, not even in creation. And injustice breaks down relationship. It leads to the breakdown of society. It is that reason for which the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once cried out, "Without justice, there can be no peace." Without justice, there can be no peace. Everything is at stake. Interestingly, in Micah 6, God is describing the breakdown of society. Lest we think it's simply God just being really mean, the desolation that is referenced here in Micah 6 is about the destruction wrought by injustice itself. Look at the links that are made here. It says that there are dishonest weights. There are imbalanced and wicked scales. Your wealthy are full of violence. Your inhabitants speak lies. All of this is about injustice, the breakdown of relationships, far greater, far more dangerous than just Eva and Eli saying, "It's not fair." There's a lot at stake for the world. And so we're caught up there at the beginning at Micah 6. Listen, hills and mountains, even the foundations of the earth. So important is this case of justice versus injustice. So important is justice to our God. We're dealing with someone totally, completely, and wholly other. How do I know that? Well, besides the witness of Scripture, the witness of our own experiences and our tradition of faith, it says right in Micah 6, what's leading to this breakdown? What's leading to this injustice? It is that the people are following the statutes of Omri. That is, they're participating in idolatry and the worship of gods outside of the true God. Interestingly, in Luke chapter 18, it says this unjust judge doesn't fear God. In other words, the implication is you can't possibly be about the work of true justice if you don't have a fear of God. So equated is justice with God. And yet, these foreign statutes of Omri, foreign to the Hebrew people, are leading them into disarray. It is no wonder that the people, when faced with this call to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with our God, when they're faced with the light of God's justice, their response is, "How can I pay you off, God? What kind of sacrifice would you like?" is the first question. When that doesn't quite get answered, the second question speaks of a year-old calf, very important to an agricultural economy. But there's no answer Then the third question jumps to a thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of oil offered to buy off God, to pay for justice. Still, no answer. And finally, the question that brings up, shall I give my child up? That is a reference to child sacrifice, and it should cause us to pause. Causes us to pause because the Hebrew culture was surrounded by religious rituals of others, other tribes and other gods who did practice all sorts of rituals, including human sacrifice and child sacrifice especially. The Bible explicitly prohibits child sacrifice. It implicitly does so when Abraham is asked to offer up Isaac and his hand is stayed. And again here, with no response, God is letting the people know, I am not like other gods. You cannot appease me with your sacrifices, not even your children. That is not what I'm looking for. For God in Micah 6, right worship must lead to right practice. The worshipful life must lead to the life of justice. In other words, God is not interested in the things these people are offering, trying to buy their way, to buy God's favor, to please God with their offerings, but rather God is interested in the kind of people they are becoming. How are we being shaped by our worship? It is as if to say that today all of our prayers, all of our songs, all of our scripture reading, all of our rituals you have seen on display would count for nothing if they don't mean something in the world that works toward justice. God is interested in our living into that work. But what is justice? It is something we argue about, we don't all agree on. In fact, a question is often asked, whose justice? There are different schools of thought about justice. We like to talk about the rule of law. We like to talk about all sorts of ways in which we believe no one is above the law. I think where I find someone helpful here is a Christian ruler of the Byzantine Empire in the 6th century, Justinian the Great, or Justinian the First. He wrote something called the Institutes of Justinian. It's a codification of Roman law, but it is through the lens of the Christian faith. It is framed by his own faith. And it is this very rule book that will later be studied and argued about. And in the medieval Christian period, something that we take for granted will be innovated, something called human rights. There is no historical moment before that period that anyone even thinks about there being inalienable rights, as we like to say, in our Constitution. Fundamental rights, innate rights, God-given rights, rights that no government can give you. They are yours by virtue of being human and is built upon this legal framework around justice. Justice in this book, for our purposes, is defined as the constant and perpetual will to render to each his due. Justice has to do with how an individual person is treated. Justice is about what someone is due, that is, they have a rightful claim to make. Justice is, by definition, not arbitrary, that is, if two cases are similar, they should be treated in the same way. And finally, justice requires an agent whose will alters the circumstances of its objects. This kind of justice is the justice that we're looking through here in Micah 6. Agents who have carried out a great, great injustice against the poor, the orphans, the widows, against those who are hungry. Hence, Micah 6 says, you will eat but not be satisfied. You will have a gnawing hunger that is directed to those wealthy committing violence in their society, leading to the breakdown through injustice. The wealthy who might have incredible access to all foods of all kinds, rich and luxurious, and yet will leave a way empty. This is the accusation made in that great courtroom drama of Micah 6. In that second courtroom drama of the widow and the unjust judge, we're told it's not because the judge is good, he's not interested in justice at all, but simply because the widow persists. Jesus makes this powerful connection. So aligned is God with justice, such a God of justice it is that we serve, totally unlike anyone else, above our own personal definitions of justice. God says, when you pray, you should approach God with a sense of justice, of seeking justice. This is that great answer to a question that has long plagued us. If God is just, how can there be suffering in our world? Jesus says to bring it to prayer. But lest we be so cynical and say, there we go again, thoughts and prayers. For Jesus, it is prayer that leads us to action. And that without it, we will certainly burn out. We will mete out our own versions of justice, perhaps much like the reign of terror in revolutionary France, or in the Soviet-style executions during the revolution in Russia. So many places, onward and upward, we find that when we mete out our personal justice, it can go awry. But when we look to God, and what God requires, it is a way of life, a way of being, to do justice, to love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. That is, it is a path in which we must listen attentively to that which God is calling us. It is God who reveals the injustice in our midst, and it is God who sends us out to do the work of justice. No one of us has the perfect definition or the perfect view of justice. We must seek it from God, the lawgiver, whose very nature is just. And so pray like the widow, Jesus says. Even if it means coming to God and saying, God, where were you when? Where were you when this happened to me? When were you when there was this great injustice? Where were you when there is this great suffering? The Christian faith does not hide away, no turn away from our suffering. It does not pretend as if everything's okay. It says the God of justice hears you and will hear you. And the question for us is, will we trust? Look at the ending of the Gospel of Luke. But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? That is the kind of faith that says, God, I will bring to you over and over the cases of injustice. I will bring before you those who are hungry, those who are houseless, those who have suffered. I will bring this before you, and I will trust that on that day, even as we work for justice now, there will be at the last the justice of God. But friends, how do I know that this is possible? I think it's right in the gospel text itself. As Jesus is talking about the unjust judge. Ironic, isn't it? Since he himself will self-refer as the judge who has come not to condemn, but that through him the world would be saved. For at the center of our Christian faith is a story of great injustice and suffering. It is that of an innocent man who is accused of something he didn't do, who is brought before a trial and he did not get a fair trial, and he is crucified, and even the criminals next to him wonder, this man is innocent. Why is he being crucified alongside us who surely deserve it? Even the criminals on the cross understand justice. They get it.
I may have deserved this because of my life, but Jesus did not. And at that cross, Jesus doesn't say, I will raise up an army and defeat you all. It doesn't strike lightning from heaven, doesn't consume everyone with fire. Jesus says, as if with all of us who suffer, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And yet, even in that seeming forsakenness, prays, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Just like last week, we learned about the power of God being shown through the creation of God and the forgiveness of God. Today, the justice of God is shown in that great cry from the cross, in which the just judge was judged in our place. The righteous judge in Jesus Christ was judged in our place. Think about that for a moment, because then we begin to catch a glimpse of the gospel. See, you might think your actions are decent enough. You might think, well, I know I sometimes get it wrong, but what you don't realize is that every wrong, every sin, every mistake, it affects our relationships, it affects our society, it affects our world, leading to its breakdown. If you were to look at every conflict, every source of destruction, every source of division, it can be found in this injustice we commit and participate in. But on the cross, Jesus says, I will hold it no longer against you. Come, repent, and be forgiven, and start anew. In some cosmic and mysterious way, the justice of God is carried out on that cross, and the true righteous judge is judged in our place, taking on the death we were heading toward and receiving the life we never merited on our own. A chance of life abundant, a chance of new life, a chance of forgiveness and reconciliation. Yes, even now, even here, even let it begin with us today. So friends, the call on our lives is to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God, for without God, we cannot be about the work of justice. Friends, will you walk in that way? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen.
Please be seated. Friends, we are celebrating the gift of music today, and we are celebrating music here at the Kirk. And I'd like you to take note of our offertory anthem entitled The Heavenly Music. And it is composed, the music, by James Berry, who is our new artist in residence, and the text by Marilyn Berry, who is no longer interim music director, but music director here at the Kirk. And it's exciting to be in the place not only of excellent music presented, but excellent music composed and presented for us. And we know the people who are doing that. There's an arresting phrase in this anthem. It is, as we still to hear these sounds, dissolved in endless whispered prayer, and here it is, the one whose universe resounds with shouts of joy is listening there. That's why we sing. That's why we have such expressive music here. That's why creative people contribute and compose and write. Because God is listening. God is very interested in what we will be doing in the next few minutes. Let us pray. Holy and merciful God, thank you for the gift of music this day. And thank you for those who compose and those who write and those who lead us in worship through music. We lift our voices and join them together because you are listening. All praise and honor to you, glorious God. May we glorify you in our offerings as well. In the name of your greatest gifts to us, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Some years ago, a former trustee, Roger Kies, endowed money to enable the Kirk to invite a prominent speaker to preach and lecture here at the church once a year. The speaker this year is Dr. Brian Blunt, a past president of Union Seminary, Richmond, and past professor of New Testament studies at Princeton Theological Seminary. Dr. Blunt was also one of Pastor Edwin's professors at Princeton, and so it was decided this year to combine and celebrate both the Kies lecture and Pastor Edwin's installation during the same weekend of October the 11th through the 13th. On Friday, October the 11th, there will be an opportunity to meet and greet Dr. Blunt along with some former pastors of the Kirk. This meet and greet will take place in St. Andrew's room at 5 p.m. prior to dinner in the refectory at 6 p.m. A lecture on the church in the public square will conclude the evening. If you would like to attend, please sign up online. Dinner is being catered by Two Unique, and you have the option to select your entree. But please note, registration is required. The cost of the evening is $65. On Saturday, October the 12th, from 9:30 to noon, Dr. Blunt will speak on Jesus on the Loose. This will be held in the St. Andrew's room, and a continental breakfast will be available. Once again, registration is required, and you may sign up on the Kirk website. Dr. Blunt will conclude the weekend by preaching on Sunday at the combined 10 a.m. service, celebrating Pastor Edwin's installation as sixth senior pastor at the Kirk. We hope you will join us to celebrate this memorable weekend. Thank you.
Brian Blount was not only a professor at Princeton Seminary for Pastor Edwin, he was also a classmate of mine. We are about approximately the same age when I was at Princeton Seminary, and we all knew back then that he was scary smart. So please come to the Kies weekend. It's going to be fantastic. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we open our hearts to your presence, filled with both gratitude and reverence. We seek to honor your call by living out justice, mercy, and humility in our lives and in our communities. Hear our prayers for justice. We pray for those who suffer under the weight of injustice, oppression, and discrimination. May your hand be upon those who are marginalized or disenfranchised, and may we as your people be instruments of change and advocates for those whose voices have been long silenced. We also remember the words of Jesus as he tells us of the persistent widow who, through her unwavering perseverance, received justice from an unjust judge. We are encouraged to pray persistently and to trust in your justice, even when it seems delayed. Lord, we bring before you the persistent cries of our hearts and the deep needs of our world. We pray for those who are struggling, feeling overwhelmed by their circumstances, and losing hope. You are a God who hears and answers. This past week, we remember the anniversary of September 11th, and we honor those who lost their lives and the families who grieve. Heavenly Father, we remember the past, but we also look forward to the future with hope. We pray for our communities that they might be places of love and support and mutual respect. Help us as your church to be a beacon of your light in the world spreading compassion and understanding and justice. And in our personal lives, may we walk humbly with you, recognizing our own limitations and relying on your strength and your guidance. Help us to listen more deeply, to understand more fully, and to act with a heart that is truly aligned with your will. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray with persistence and to seek your justice with unwavering faith, we pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You may be seated. As we receive our blessing and our charge, we're reminded that we're not just blessed for our souls, ourselves. We're blessed to be a blessing to others. So to continue that blessing, you're of course all invited to a reception down in Heritage Hall, where we will continue to celebrate Dr. Marilyn Beery and her ministry among us, as well as all the music ministry that you have heard today and in the years to come. Keep them in your prayers. And please introduce yourself to Reverend Jim Mosley at the reception, as he will be spending some time as a temporary pastor here in our midst to help in every way he can. And for that, I am most grateful. And friends, I task you now to go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good, and render no one evil for evil, but instead lift up the faint-hearted and defend the weak, and honor all of God's children and all of God's creation, remembering to seek justice, do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with our God. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and evermore. And God's people say, Amen. Amen.